they'd be number one. Right now, if they could rap or sing along with their incredible dancing in the 90s, there's no doubt in my mind that they would be probably the biggest drawing act in the world.
The most amazing, amazing dancers I ever seen in my life. Ever.
Sell lucky numbers over the radio?
Uh-huh.
No, what else do you do?
Oh, we sing, we dance.
All right, let me hear you sing.
Lucky number.
The Nicholas Brothers, Harold and Fayard, gelden algemeen als een van de beste dansduo's aller tijden. Hun carrière bestrijkt een periode van 60 jaar en toch is hun verhaal nog nooit verteld.
Table with 13 dishes. Is you make me.
You sing? Can you dance? Well, I'll take a chance. I'll ski. I'll ski.
Suck it up, Timmy. Bop, 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 bop.
Vanaf het ogenblik dat ze het podium betraden, oogsten de Nicholas Brothers overal ter wereld daverend succes. De Nicholas Brothers en hun zus Dorothy brachten het grootste deel van hun jeugd door in Philadelphia, waar hun ouders het orkest leidden van het Standard Theater, een variété-theater voor zwart publiek.
I was told, when I was born, my mother used to take me to the theater in the bassinet, and she sit me right beside the piano as she was playing, and my dad was playing, and the rest of the orchestra. So I guess that's how I got rhythm.
I had memories of my daddy and my mommy. My mommy, my mother. When they were working in the theater, you know, in Philadelphia. And they used to come home, and brother would be talking to him about how he enjoyed the show, because he used to go to the theater there practically every day and watch the dances and things, you know. I guess maybe he's told you this, or you've heard it before.
He taught me some steps, and we used to do things together, and we would show mother and dad, but obviously I was not anxious enough about it, as Fayard was. So then he said, I'm going to start teaching Harold.
I was showing him a step. And he was having trouble getting this step. So I saw that he was having trouble. So I said, listen, we'll do it tomorrow. I see you having a little trouble now. And he said, no, no, I want to do it now. I said, now listen to me. We'll do it tomorrow. All right? He said, no, I want to learn it now. I said, okay. So I started teaching him again. And we went on and on for an hour. He finally got it.
All I did was follow him. I followed him and tried to do what he asked me to do and what he wanted to teach me to do.
Dorothy wilde van het dansen geen beroep maken. Maar Harold en Fayard zouden een uniek duo worden. Fayard bedacht de acts voor zichzelf en voor zijn broer.
At the Standard Theater, I saw the Berry Brothers. Lenny Reed and Willie Bryant, Bucking Bubbles.
The rhythm's okay in Harlem, and they swing it along. Yes, the rhythm's okay in Harlem,
I enjoyed them immensely. And I remember I would go to our apartment, the Gibson apartments, and I would start trying to do steps that I saw the other dancers do in the living room. And I would dance from the living room into the kitchen and from the kitchen on the fire escape. So I was dancing all over the place. And my father saw me as I was practicing. And he was a great influence on me. He said, son, he said, what you're doing, it's great. I like it. He said, but don't do what the other dancers do. Do your own thing. I said, okay, Dad. All right. And he said, listen, when you're performing, don't look at your feet. Look at that audience, because you're entertaining them, not yourself. I said, okay, Dad. Fine. And he said, that's something that you do I like very much. I said, what is that, Dad? He said, I like the way you use your hands. He said, do more of that. I said, okay, Dad.
My mother and daddy decided to manage us because once they saw us doing a routine or something, they decided to manage us and quit their job as head of the orchestra in the Standard Theater in Philadelphia. And they were going to manage us. I guess they saw something there also. So, and so we went from there. That's when it started. Things started growing bit by bit, getting in vaudeville show, you know, in the theaters.
The Lincoln Theater, it was on the corner of Biddle and Pennsylvania Avenue. And that's where I first met the Nicholas kids, Fayard, his sister, and Harold. And his mother and father played the orchestra. They were in the pit. She was the pianist and he the drummer. And that was my first encounter with the Nicholas brothers. I don't remember how good or how bad. All I know is they stopped the show. And my partner and I couldn't get on. In these theaters, they had different acts. And we had to wait. We had to wait. They were applauding so for the Nicholas kids. And then they brought out Harold, who could hardly walk out, to do the encore. And that just made it worse. We hardly got on at all. When we did get on, they were still applauding for the Nicholas kids.
Chicago was hearing about us. New York was hearing about us. Baltimore was hearing about us. And every city you can mention, hearing about the Nicholas kids or the Nicholas brothers.
Nicholas Brothers' debut in New York was at the Lafayette Theater. That was at 131st Street and 7th Avenue. And they were seen there by someone and they went into the Cotton Club.
I first played the Cotton Club in 1930. It was on the same side of the street as the Savoy Ballroom. And on a corner of 142nd Street, over top of it, was the Cotton Club, over top of this theater. And just next to the theater, there was a small entrance, and the entrance was upstairs. When he got there, it was fair. Nice one. Herman Stark said he's got these kids, and he's going to give them a shot. That's all. He came in and they put him in the show. And they did a fabulous job.
In het jaar van hun debuut in de Cotton Club maakten ze ook hun eerste film.
Well, my brother and I, we always wanted to make movies. And now we were going to make the short for Warner Brothers. And with the bright lights and the camera there, which was different from stage.
Much
different. Yes.
Well, because naturally, you had an audience on when you work on the stage, uh-huh. But in front of the cameras, you have no audience. All you have is a camera.
Yeah. So the camera and was so, the audience.
Yeah. So you have to get that feeling
get
up
that
as
feeling.
If that is
they were really out there.
Mm-hmm. Listen. remember anything about Parkhead Blackbird, but you, I'm sure you do, because you used to tell me about it all.
Yes, I did, didn't I?
What do you remember
wait,
about
it? Let me refresh my memory.
I try to, but every time I look at it and see it, I just can't be, it doesn't come back to me. I don't know why.
Oh, you don't?
But, wait a minute. What's that? There's something we do, the part we do with Nina Mae McKinney.
She's in the kitchen making this pie.
I vaguely remember.
And we come in, we were outside playing, little boys with our short trousers.
What is that, Miss Nana?
Now listen, Gates, you run along and chase yourself. This pie ain't ready yet.
Well, what kind of pie is that, Miss Nana?
That's a blackbird pie.
A blackbird pie? There ain't no such thing as a blackbird pie.
Al gauw werd de naam van de Nicholas Brothers even nauw verbonden met de Cotton Club als die van Cab Calloway, Ethel Waters en Duke Ellington.
Many Broadway stars and many Hollywood stars would always come to the Cotton Club. And I said to Herman Stocks, who was the manager of the Cotton Club and then became our manager. So I said, I'd like to go out there and meet these stars. He said, okay. Going out there. So after the show, we would go out and go right to the table of whoever would be there. If it was George Raff, or Tallulah Bankhead, or Eleanor Power, we'd go down and say, hello. And they say, hello, sit down. What would you have? I say, we'd like to have some orange juice.
Tallulah Bankhead came to see a show we were in. And she called us and wanted us to come out and see her, because we were the only ones that could go out front and sit and talk with in the audience, you know, with the people, because we were youngsters anyway, you know. And she said, oh, you're wonderful, I love you. You know, well, thank you very much. And I said, oh, we love you too. She says, when is your birthday? And I told her such and such. Well, how would you like a picture of me? I'd love a picture of you. Yes? Oh, that's nice. Would you like a bicycle? And I floated in and said, yeah, I would love a bicycle. So, well, which would you prefer, the picture or the bicycle? I said, I'd like them both if I could have them. And she laughed and said, oh, darling, you shall have both of them. And the very next day, the postman rang, and there was a bicycle and a big photograph of Tallulah Bankhead. And I rode that bicycle all over Harlem. Everybody knew about that bicycle.
They didn't allow black people to come into the Cotton Club in those days, uptown. Didn't care how much money you had. If you came up, if you rode up there in a limousine, with diamonds and everything, the doorman would stop you. And the doorman was black. And he'd fight you if you tried to go into the Cotton Club. Those were his orders. So I didn't like that at all. There was nothing I could do about it. But I think my brother and I really started something that was good, even though we were just little kids. When I asked Herman Stocks if I could go out and meet all these great stars. And he said, go on. And then when I got a little older, I said, maybe the reason why we could go out there because we were just little kids. But I'm glad we did go out there, because we could show them that black people had class.
Tegen de tijd dat de Cotton Club verhuisde naar Times Square, waren de Nicholas Brothers grote vedetten.
A Cotton Club show was a show that was made up of actors, singers, dancers, and they made three huge ensemble numbers in every show. And then the acts were between them.
For an encore, Cap Calloway would say to my brother, come on out here. I heard that you do an impression of me.
Dances.
Ook Hollywood hoorde al spoedig van de Nicholas Brothers. En in 1934 engageerde Sam Goldwyn ze voor de film Kid Millions. Al gauw pendelden de broers heen en weer tussen Oost- en Westkust. In 1936 maakten ze hun Broadway-debuut in de Ziegfeld Follies met Fanny Brice, Josephine Baker en Bob Hope.
When we were coming up, yeah. I mean, we were not like most of the other dancers when they were together, brother acts.
No.
Or dancing acts together, no. Which they used to argue and fight all the time. But we never did that, I mean.
No, we didn't.
Sure, we may have been
disagreements
about this and that, you know. Yeah, uh-huh. I don't like that step, or that ain't the right step or something. You know?
We never did say that.
It never got into fist fights or anything.
No, no.
Never. Man, I would have beat you up.
In datzelfde jaar, 36, staken ze voor het eerst de Atlantische Oceaan over.
We went to England on the boat. And I got sick. Sick all the way, practically. I remember that. But it was nice, playing shuffleboard and all that stuff. And we were going over there for a review. Lou Leslie's Blackbirds. Going to do that show over there. We were really almost a novelty, you know, so to speak, over there, because they hadn't seen so many black people in at one time, much. And it was nice, but everybody was, you know, they were just normal, treating everybody wonderfully.
Na hun terugkomst in Amerika speelden ze mee in de succesvolle Broadway musical van Rodgers and Hart, Babes in Arms. In de choreografie van Georges Balanchine. Tegelijkertijd traden ze tot diep in de nacht op in de nabijgelegen Cotton Club. 'S Middags kregen ze privéles in hun appartement in Sugar Hill, het exclusieve deel van Harlem. Nu hun naam in de showbusiness was gevestigd, waren ze de trots van de zwarte gemeenschap.
Outside of the art for us, they were symbols. They meant something. They meant a great deal to our community, to young blacks especially here. I don't know about the outside world, but they were our heroes at that time. Still are, you know. People like Bill Robinson and the Nicholas Brothers and Joe Louis and. You know, they stick out in our minds as the people who inspired us and who we looked up to, you know, during those hard days in this country.
Back in the Depression days when they got their start, many, many performers, of course, yearned to be like the Nicholas Brothers. I wanted to be like the Nicholas Brothers. I wanted their success. I wanted to look like them and act like them and make that kind of money. In a large town like New York or Chicago, you would see a very important film advertised, and on the marquee it would announce the presence of the black performers. Even though they were only on the screen for 2 or 3 minutes, that meant the world to the black community, of course.
People would say that we reminded them of the Nicholas Brothers, and that or we would be the next Nicholas Brothers. And so I hadn't seen them yet, but I was aware of them. I think in my little mind, I figured they must be great, because I thought we were pretty good, and I figured they must be great. And I thought that that was going to be, we were going to be the next Nicholas Brothers, until I saw them. And then when I saw them, I realized that nobody was going to be the next Nicholas Brothers, least of all my brother and I.
When people come to me and tell me, isn't Michael Jackson a great dancer? I said, what? What are you talking about? Did you see him get up on his toes? What are you talking about? Pops and Louie did that. The Nicholas Brothers did that. Don't come to me and tell me something that's going to make me become truly angry that you don't do your history, especially as black dancers, and don't know where that greatness comes from. That comes from those people who came before us. And the Michael Jackson, Janet Jackson, all these dancers, that are supposed to be dancers now don't come close to the Nicholas Brothers.
Na een tournee door Zuid-Amerika werden ze in 1939 door 20th Century Fox gecontracteerd voor de musical Down Argentine Way.
When we went to the rehearsal hall to meet Nick Castle, because he was the choreographer for the whole picture with everybody. And he greeted us and said, oh, I'm so happy to meet you guys. He says, now there's somebody who can do my ideas. I know you can do my ideas. He said, because all I'm doing here is with the little starlets, a one and a two and a three. And he says, I got so much in me. I want it to come out. He says, I know you can do my ideas. The sneak preview of Down Argentine Way were whistling and stomping their feet and clapping their hands, that the operator in the projection room had to rewind the film and show it over again. And because of that, 20th Century Fox gave us a 5-year contract.
Samen met choreograaf Nick Castle maakten ze nog 5 films voor 20th Century Fox. Tin Pan Alley, The Great American Broadcast, Sun Valley Serenade, waarin ze danste met Harold's latere vrouw Dorothy Dandridge, Orchestra Wives en Stormy Weather. De enige film met een rolbezetting van uitsluitend zwarte sterren. De filmmaatschappij gebruikte hen alleen als een nummer tussendoor. Als zwarte artiesten kregen ze nooit een echte rol of zelfs maar enige tekst. Maar die korte optredens maakten hen wel internationaal bekend.
They're so much ahead of classical dance. They didn't need it to, you know. What's extraordinary that you recognize their style. They opened so many doors to so many people. In later years, look at this, you recognize their style in breakdancing. You recognize their step in steps in rap. You recognize that, you know, those things would never be... Hey, but they are the chain. They are the chain, and that's why their art is so important.
Yo, sound the bell. School is in. Can't touch this.
But you know one thing?
What?
I don't like the way that they videotape some of the dancers.
No?
You know, it seems as though they just say, whoever it is, if it's, mm-hmm. What's his name? J.C. Hammer?
Hammer?
Yeah.
Not J.C.
What is
MC.
Oh, is M? Oh, yeah. MC.
But he's cut out the MC.
So he's just Hammer.
If you could hide and watch me watch them, you would see that it takes me to, I'd be like a kid in a candy factory, because when I see these moves executed, it's thrilling. It's funny. It's funny that they could think of doing that particular move. and I'd be rolling all around the room. Every time I put the pause button and laugh and giggle and then try to do it.
He's going into his thing. All of a sudden, they cut to something else. Just like that.
Yeah. Yeah, but I mean, for me, with Hammer, it's all right, because it's exciting every time, whatever they do with it, because he's moving all the time, you know. And he's gone, he's working, you know, and the feet work and everything. And yes. But some of the others who don't dance as well as he does during that type of dancing and stuff,
it's kind of judgy.
You don't have to do quick cuts. You do quick cuts when dancers can't dance. I'm in video world, I know what they do. You don't need quick cuts for the Nicholas Brothers. You let them do, and they score. Makes it easy for a director when you have greatness. When you have greatness, let's cut to the middle of their body because their legs don't go up, and I don't understand that. What's wrong with their arms? Let's get a shot of the underarm. I know, I've heard them talk in meetings. See, but the Nicholas Brothers, you know, you just say, let them dance. And then we got a great video there.
K-A-L-A-M-A-C-O. Want a gal, a real flipper. She's a fine chick. I'm gonna make my bid for the freckle-faced kid I'm hurrying to. Going to Michigan to see the sweetest gal in Kalamazoo.
Like the term flash act, and I remember in a movie that's entertainment, I think Sammy Davis said they were a flash act, and that was the term for those kind of acts. They did sort of acrobatics and stuff. To me, the Nicholas Brothers were never flash because they did close floor work too. They could do everything, and I don't like labels, and I certainly didn't like it label about my favorite and my greatest. What put them in a category? Flash was trivialized them. They were never trivialized to me. They did everything. So how could you put them in a label, you know? Imagine what the Nicholas Brothers could have done had they had the opportunity. Oh, it's frightening. But maybe that's why they weren't given the opportunity.
You talk about your Donald O'Connells and Sammy Davis Jr. and many of the other entertainers. He has it. He does everything. Just like they do, only he does it better.
People probably would say Fred Astaire was a natural dancer, you know, because he danced from head to toe. So like I always say that if my brother, you know, got together with Fred Astaire, it would be one Fred Astaire or one Fayard Nicholas, because I think that they were that close.
Those acrobatics, elements of acrobatics, were never intentionally to punch audience to their face. They were all the time emotionally attached to the dance. They knew exactly where is the climax of the dance, where they can really dance easy and cool, and when they are a smack audience across the face, when they tease the audience, they were and that's a sign of just a true choreographic mind.
And they just come down off of people's tables, you know, where people are sitting at tables, and they hit on the stairs. I mean, it's great. That's great. The dance hasn't even started yet. So now, once they start the dance, they go into it. It's very jazzy. I remember, you know, it's very jazzy, and they're very relaxed. They're just dancing, nice and easy, and they're just setting the thing up that they're going to now dance. And then when they go over to where the bandstand is,
They move over to the bandstand, and as soon as they jump up there, I mean, now they're painting another picture. You know, I forget, I think the music at that point was ba-yi, and they're going, now we're building. And now they jump off of that, and that's the first time they jump into splits. And now we haven't even warmed up yet, but they jump off that thing into splits and come up. Now they go up these stairs, up on a landing there. And at that point, I thought that this is where the number is going to end, because it was pretty, they've been dancing a while. Then they jump on a piano top. And that point, at that point in the number, I think even now, just to show that, where they jump on that piano top, it's one of the most powerful, it's real power tap dancing. Because they jump on the piano, and it goes, do 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 do, and they do something like, bop, da di do bop, do 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 do, eat, ah, da gig, bop. And it's, and then, after that, then they jump off the piano. Now we're jumping from another higher level. Now it's not just the band. And now it's off the piano. They jump into splits. So now they move along. They move out of there, and they move into this area where in the back of them is this big thing. And, you know, at that point, I thought maybe my heart might burst. Even now when I see them go in front of that thing, I think to myself, you know, what are they going to do? Project themselves was pure class. That's all it was.
We did vaudeville. We did nightclubs. Mm-hmm. We did movies. We did television. We, like I said before to other people who have interviewed us, that we have done everything in show business except opera. And all these things that I wanted to do has come true.
Did you ever want to do opera?
Oh, yes.
Really?
I do a tap dancing opera. I didn't say, oh, soul on me, yo.
A tap dancing opera.
In the Broadway musical St. Louis Woman, bood Harold Arlen, Harold Nicholas, bij wijze van uitzondering, de gelegenheid om te zingen. En dat zou een klassieker worden.
all the great songs that were written in those days. When I was coming up, I learned them all. I was young, but I knew all the songs, all of Duke Ellington, Harold Arlen, and Johnny Mercer, and all those people. All those songs I knew, you know. But I never got a chance to really sing them like I wanted to on the stage in front of an audience or something, you know. So that was kind of, it was kind of hard for me because I thought about it a lot, you know. Why won't they let me sing? Because we were dancers, they said, you know. Just, and that was it. I wanted to, though.
When you start talking about Fred Astaire and Gene Kelly, you know, why do people not say, you know, and Harold and Fayard Nicholas, you know, why don't they say that? You know, it's something that it bubbles inside of me.
We were doing the Pirate, a movie with Gene Kelly and Vincent Minnelli directing, and we had a routine to do with Kelly where we all in synchronization, you know, just the three of us doing the same thing. It was Gene Kelly's routine, you know, and so we learned that and we were rehearsing one day and naturally me, I don't put my heart and soul into rehearsals, you know, I'm doing it just like, you know, lackadaisical and all that. And Kelly looks at me, he says, Harold, what's the matter with you? I said, what do you mean? He said, you're not doing a routine. I said, well, I know it. He says, what do you mean you know it? Because he and my brother were doing the routine like the cameras were rolling, you know, and everything. And they were perspiring and carrying on. He said, no, man, we're working our heads off and you just moping along. I said, but I know the routine, you know. He says, you don't know it. You can't know it. We're doing like that. He said, Fayard, Gene Kelly told me, let's sit down and watch him do the routine. He says he knows it, but I bet he doesn't. Let him do it. So I says, okay, I'll do it. Bam, music strikes up. And I go through the routine, bang, 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 bang. Everything. Right to the very end, you know, like we were going on camera or something. And I finish it, da-da, I said, how's that? And Gene Kelly was so mad, he didn't know what to do.
They were at a time, and as gifted as they were, at a time when it was exceptional, unusual, but was not to be tolerated by a lot of people who didn't feel that they should get too far. And I hate to put this on that basis, but unfortunately that's what has existed throughout the United States. If you get too good, they won't hire you.
The fact that one black was making it at that time, Sammy Davis Jr., does not change the fact that the reason that the Nicholas Brothers didn't make it is because there wasn't room for more than just one black. There was room for a Fred Astaire and a Gene Kelly and a Ginger Rogers and a host of others, but only one black. And his wasn't the movements of a Nicholas Brothers. The Nicholas Brothers would have been a threat to a Fred Astaire or Gene Kelly, because if I can walk on air, it's great if I'm the only one who can do it, but if two more guys come in here and they both can walk on the air and they walk a little higher in the air than I do, then what I do isn't so fantastic anymore.
Work was getting pretty scarce, shall we say, you know, and we'd work here and there, and but it wasn't weekly or constantly like it was before. So we said, and to fight that and the racism, I mean, it was heavy, you know. So we said, ooh, the minute we got a chance to go to Europe, we jumped at it, you know, and went over there right, and stayed. First time we stayed 4 years, you know, and just had a ball because of the difference, you know, in the way that you're treated. It was fantastic, you know, especially for me. I said, hey, what is going on? This is great, you know, because nobody just, no, your money's not good enough, you know, because your color's not right. No, we never got anything like that, you know. So naturally, you automatically love this. Why not? So I wanted to stay.
Na een aantal jaren in Europa begon Harold aan een solo carrière in Parijs, terwijl Fayard terugkeerde naar Los Angeles.
I got homesick. I wanted to come home, see my family. So I told my brother, I want to go home. He said, well, what? You're going home and take care of the business. I'll come later. So I went back home, and he stayed in Europe, I think, 7 years. 7 years before we got together again.
Welcome back. How was it in Gay Paris?
Very good.
Do you remember this step?
Yeah. Wait it now. Don't. Not too much. 7 years is a long time now.
Cool it. Take it easy.
I think I can get into that. Come on, let's try it together. Are you ready?
I'm ready. Oh, wait a minute. Hold the phone.
Huh?
What was that?
Same step with just a little French accent.
Ah, mais oui.
Na hun hereniging bleven ze optreden voor televisie en in nachtclubs. Helaas kreeg Fayard gewrichtsontsteking, zodat zelfs lopen hem veel pijn bezorgde.
I was working with my brother when I had this arthritis. And we were doing a tour with Sammy Davis Jr. And I was in so much pain, still trying to do those splits. So my brother, he saw the trouble that I was having. And so he said, don't do that. Don't do those splits. He said, just let me do it. He said, you just use your hands. And when I go down, you go down with my hands, and then you bring me up with your hands. I said, all right, thank you.
Now that he's had the, the hip replacement, he can move, he can get around. He can't dance like, like you say, dancing. But he can do a few things, you know, and which makes it wonderful. And I used to feel very hurt myself watching him, you know. Because that's his life. Dancing was his.
So I had two hip replacements. And I guess you could call me the $6 million man. Because now I'm walking better and dancing a little bit. Well, I'll show you what I mean.
Harold treedt nog steeds op in theaters en films. Fayard kreeg onlangs een Tony Award voor zijn choreografiebijdrage aan de Broadway-show Black and Blue en verschijnt regelmatig in het openbaar. Gezamenlijk verschijnen ze nog wel eens bij speciale gelegenheden.
I think that their political statement came out in their art, in their craft, because we as black people who did not have those opportunities or have that needed to see that that existed and needed to see that that was a goal that one could aspire to.
If the Nicholas Brothers could be defined by any one thing, which they can't, I think the Stormy Weather number can just hold up. You know, it is like Shakespeare. Generation after generation will be amazed at what they do.
I would still like to have had my own show.
Uh-huh.
Or my own movie, or, you know, a movie for me.
Well,
featuring me, Harold Nicholas, and...
Hal Nicholas?
Yeah, you know.
And his
something
brother.
Something like that.
They started out the Cotton Club, but it was nothing other than they were a great act. People liked them. They loved them. They established it there, and they have maintained it over a period of 60, 70 years. That's a remarkable thing.
If they had all of that in this point in time, all of that energy and all of that creativity, God knows what they would be doing, man. These cats would be levitating. You know what I'm saying? I don't know what they would be doing. There's nobody like that. There really isn't, you know?
See, I was speaking for both of us.
No, yeah. You're not. No, the thing is, you have to speak for yourself, because that's what
people want to know.
And then I speak for myself.
Okay. Well, then that's...
But that doesn't mean that we're not still brothers.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
When they dance together, it's magical, and anybody has got any emotion and any feeling and any truth to themselves will react truthfully to that and give them the standing ovation they deserve.
Love to each other, to the audience, a great, great dignity in them. They're always... they will always Nicholas Brothers. They never step down. They step many stairs down, but never step down in who they are, who they were, and who they are now.
Say, let's reminisce a little bit and show a film clip when we were younger.
Much younger. Because if you're thinking of the same one I am, we were much younger.
That's the one.
All right.
That's the one I'm thinking of.
All right, let's get to it.
Well, let's do it.
Thank you. Episoden uit de Nederlandse dansgeschiedenis van 1645 tot heden. Aanstaande dinsdag in De Danswoede, 8 minuten voor 8 op Nederland 3.